Hi, and welcome to 5.2 Costs and Revenues. And today it's as part of the Topic 5 Operations Management, going from 6.11 up to 7.31. This is following on from production methods, where we had a look at the job batch mass and flow and sell, and you use this sort of stuff to then go into your break-even analysis to work out your TFC and your TVC and your contribution. Let's make a start. On here, I've got a summary sheet for you to make it nice and easy. I've got more detailed notes you'll notice in the description bar. They're in the PDF form to make it nice and useful for you, and there's also a worksheet for you too. On here, I just want to point out that price is different to cost, profit is different to revenue, and profit's different to contribution. Notice that they're all sort of 4-mark questions roughly. These things are pretty common when it comes into doing break-even. They'll ask you as a definition, and then ask you to then go into a break-even question later on. It's going to be 80% declarative, so we've got cost, revenue, and contribution as our main sort of ideas to get for knowledge. And some of the skills you're going to get is how to actually do the contribution formula, and we'll get into that bit later on. I got this really good video from this lady who goes through and describes direct and indirect costs. A lot of detail behind this, so if you want to go through and watch a video in a different time, different pace, just type in the description at the top, or just get a name, Pamela D. Jones, WCU, and she'll give you all the information. Also have a look at how much it costs to make a video, and this guy goes into his detail about making production videos, and how the more complexity it gets, the more cost it gets. It's good for variables. And lastly, we've got Mega Factories of Lego section. That's the second part. This is great stuff to go watch. Highly recommend if you've got some time to just get into it and have a go. What do you have to do by the end of today to be able to say you've been successful? Can you define your fixed, variable, semi-variable, direct, indirect, your overheads and contribution? Quite a mouthful there. Can you explain each of the ideas? So once you've defined them, can you explain them, say, for 4 marks rather than 2? And can you give some examples and pick them out of the case going, that looks like direct, that looks like indirect, that looks like fixed, that looks like variable. These look like contribution when working out the formula. If you can do all of those things, then you're heading towards your 2 and your 4 marks to get some pretty good scores. All right. Just for the definitions for you to get into our DOL 2 stuff, direct costs, these are basically clearly identified. So these are very similar to sort of your variable costs, but the idea is that you're clearly linking them to them. So if you imagine the Coke can, the outside of the label and so forth, because it has the actual Coke printing on it, it's directly related to it. But if you imagine the aluminium that's to go up and actually make the can itself, that aluminium could go in all sorts of other different Coke products. So you might call those the aluminium cost per unit, the variable cost, but the printing of the label on the actual Coke can is directly attached to that Coke product. That would be like a direct cost. These are pretty much called your cost of goods sold on your profit and loss statements. And these, more or less when you add them all together, you get your TVC. I'll talk about it a bit later on. Your indirect costs, these more or less go together with your fixed, and the other word for them also is your overheads. And these are the ones, even if you make nothing, you still have to pay for it. So you've got to pay rent, you've got to pay marketing, you've got to pay full-time wages. So even if all the machines stop and nothing's happening, you're not making any output, you still have to pay these things anyway. And these are often the biggest hassles to business, because sometimes business will stop because of pest factors, and you just got to do it anyway. The last one, which is a little bit sort of a mishmash in between, is the semi-variable costs. And the semi-variable stuff, it starts off like your fixed costs, but then can go up and go down. And as you know, like most things, they tend to go up. If you want the example of this one, think about like your mobile phone plans, where you pay one flat monthly fee. Even if you don't use your phone, you still have to pay for it. And then it gets to a point where you go over your data allowances, and then after that, it starts going up per megabyte that you use. So I was paying my $39.95, and after that, 5 cents every megabyte, dun dun dun, as it goes up. It doesn't appear a lot in exams, but just know that it's there. Okay, we'll do some picture explanations for you. And this here is this Coke bottle. And I chucked it up there because I thought it was really cool. Instead of imagine having the round Coke bottles like that, and you've got this dead space, they thought about making them into like square ones. And with the square ones, that sort of dead space, as they're packed together like that, dead space is removed. So you're decreasing your variable costs and also making it easier and lighter to ship stuff in theory. And also you can press them down and crunch them down to go recycle them. Coke didn't go on with this, but I thought it was a pretty cool idea to get into. If you like a diagram stuff, here's your costs and your outputs, and just select the more output I do, the more the costs go up. And that's the basic idea. When I add together my things like water to make my Coke, my sugar, and my bottle, all of these things would be considered my direct costs or variable costs. When I add them all together, I get my total variable costs. And you need those a bit later on when you're working out 5.3 to do some of your costing stuff. The other stuff you can also get into is this, which is the indirect fixed or overhead costs. And these are like your TFC parts. Your TFC, if you have a look at this diagram here, it just goes straight across. So even if you make nothing, your output stays constant. Sorry, you don't make any output, you still have to pay the cost. So in your factory, this might be like your rent or like your mortgage payments if you're on a fixed rate. Your marketing costs, so paying out for your billboards and your TV and everything else, even if you make nothing, the marketing is still going to charge you. And your full-time wages, so your workers that turn up full-time to do it, even if the factory's not running, you're still going to pay these guys. This is the big idea. It doesn't change with the level of output. Add them all together and you get your total fixed cost. So if I had to put it all together to give yourself this thing called TC or total cost, if I get my bottle, my water, my sugar, I get to my marketing, my full-time wages, and my factory, I'm going to have these two line graphs. So I'm going to have the line graph of here of my total variable costs and my total fixed costs. When I add them all together, I get this thing here called total cost. And notice how the line is going up. So here is like the variable where it starts. And when I add on my fixed costs, that's where the line starts going up. And you're going to use this later on with your break even. Just notice that there's TFC, then TVC, and then TC for total cost when you combine them both together. All right, other part you also get is revenue. That's the other part too they can give you as a question. The most basic way of working it out is you get the unit price of whatever you're selling times it by the quantity you sold. So if it costs a dollar, sorry, my unit price was a dollar. Sorry, I didn't change that word, not cost, but the price of it was a dollar, and I sell 100, my revenue is going to be $100. This one too, with the more output that you make, in theory, the more revenue that you get. So it's constant growth as it goes up. Just know that revenue can come in tons and tons of forms. And these are linked back to 3.1 sources of finance in your working capital cycle. You can sell dormant or fixed assets. That means revenue is going to come in. You can just go and sell products. You can also sell, get dividends in and your interest coming in as well. So just know there are many different ways that revenue can come into your business. And these all go into your profit and loss, your sales in sales revenue as it comes on in. All right, this is the DOL too, so there's some skills stuff. So one of the questions they can give you is how do you work out contribution to profit? So basically, you get your unit price, $4, and funnily enough here, you minus off, and notice it's AVC here, the average variable costs. And when I get into the FIFO, LIFO stuff later on, a bit more sense with this. Basically, you minus off your variable costs all combined together. So across here, what you've got is this ends up making the actual part to profit. How much did this contribute to my profit? So the part that's missing out of here is called the fixed cost part. I know it sounds kind of confusing right now, but basically you just got three parts. Unit selling price, minus off the variable costs, and this will give you your profit. The other part that's being made up in this diagram is the fixed costs. All right, we'll jump on to the next section. Now here, feel free to pause once you've read through it. I just want you to go through and see if you can identify and state why some of the direct costs might be greater than the indirect costs. Have a pause, feel free. All right, so in McDonald's, some of the direct costs, so if you're gonna make like a Big Mac, we're gonna have the wrapper, we're gonna have the buns, and remember the two all beef patties, special sauce, lettuce, cheese, pickles, onion, and a sesame seed bun. There's my Big Mac. That's been in my head for probably 25 plus years now. There'd be some of my direct costs. The indirect costs might be my full-time employees there, and also the rent on the building. In the Long Bay Jail, same sort of thing. So prisoners' uniforms, they might also have the meals they have. So the more prisoners they get, the more they have to pay with these direct costs. And maybe the full-time waiters, like this guy here. His job is to look after it. Even if there are no prisoners, they still have to pay this guy, in theory. Otherwise, they shut the prison down, of course. And if you look at Southwest High, what are some of the direct costs there? Directly attributed to making education real for you, so textbooks, pencils, and paper. But what are some of the indirect costs? You might have the full-time employees, you might have, say, some of the municipal costs you've got to pay for each of the buildings. You might even bring into, if you wanted to get, down and dirty, the semi-variable, maybe electricity, mobile phone plans for some of the staff, how it came together. Why would they have greater direct than indirect costs on these ones? They may actually own the building outright, so they don't have to pay the rent. They may also have none of the employees aren't actually full-time, they're all casual. So the more the worker works, the more you have to pay the cost. And you might also have some of the marketing they've just gotten rid of altogether because they need to market their product. It's got such a strong brand. So the big idea is that they're mainly paying their variable costs more than their indirect because they own their own buildings, they don't have full-time employees, and essentially they make their marketing almost non-existent because they can't see the point of paying it anymore. Factor in there just to make it a bit tricky for you, but just to make you think as you go through. Right, on here we've got to have a look at Shell. Shell's a ginormous business. I think if you added together Shell and BP, they were, if you combine their revenues, they were actually making $1 trillion. So it's a phenomenal amount. Have a look on Y charts for a bit of details, but this company makes a lot of money around the world. Feel free to pause it now, and I'll go into the details for you. Cool. All right, so what's the costs and revenues associated with making diesel? You're definitely going to have your total fixed costs, your total variable costs, and your revenues that come in. So with my total fixed costs, I'm going to go back and it sounds like I'm harping on, but what's my rent? What's my marketing? What's my full-time employees? What's my variable costs? So I'm going to be getting my base ingredients. So I'll be taking my unrefined crude oil, and then I'll be going through the distilling process. I might use all the different nuts and bolts and everything else to put this together. Once it's gone through and they've taken out the diesel, they then take out the different types of petrol and they get the primo stuff off the top. All of these raw materials would be considered the direct costs. What's the revenue? So the revenue goes out from their diesel sales, their petrol sales, their gas sales. All of these things are the money coming in. And if they sell off some of their assets, perhaps, or they get some dividends and interest from lending out to different people through debentures, they might get some money out of that too. So what's the big impact on businesses when the cost of diesel increases? So they might have, for instance, they've already worked out their variable costs for doing their diesel and for the big trucks moving around your factories. Once that goes up, what you're doing is you're actually increasing the gradients of the curve. So instead of it being a nice level part, your actual unit cost of doing each one is actually making the gradient get higher and higher. What does that do? Well, it definitely makes your break-even point get higher up, makes it harder to achieve. It also going to cause your profits to get less. It might also cause some stakeholder conflict because people want to get more money out and they want to make sure they potentially might outsource the business or offshore it. What's some good bits on this one? Sounds like a bit funny thing, but it might lead to better innovation. How do we actually get these costs cheaper? And it might also cause moving your R&D to get better ideas coming out of it. You might also patent some of these ideas. So even when there's a negative, there's still a positive there for it. All right, I've got an IB case study here for you about stir fry. Feel free to pause it and have a read through, and then we'll go on to the question. All right, on this one here, notice it says explain the difference. So you could almost put distinguish between fixed and variable costs to make it a bit easier. If we're trying to get our 4 marks, you'd be defining your fixed costs. So my fixed costs would be ones that don't change with the level of output, and these would be, for example, the rent, his van and staff, as comes from the case study. And the variable costs would be the ones that do change with the level of output, such as chicken, rice, plates, and electricity. Now you're going to go through two different ones, and you could talk about one changes with the level of output, such as fixed, whereas variable does change with the level of output. Please don't put things down like spelling and pronunciation. That won't get you any marks. Your fixed costs also, when they go in, they tend to be the ones that have to be met first by a business. And the variable cost then comes secondary. It's like a timing thing. You could also possibly argue that the business that he's in right now, you might say that his fixed costs, because he's starting up, they're going to be much more expensive than his variable costs. If you can get down two differences and define fixed and variable with examples, you're heading towards your 4 marks on that one. Right, here's a bit of a tougher question for you. So I'm trying to bring together all those costs and put in sort of an economic sense and talk about this thing called inflation. So what happens if one big business who's responsible, say like the diesel we talked about before, what happens if their costs get higher? How does that impact on the businesses around that rely on that diesel? So feel free to pause, and if you're looking for the YouTube link to go have a look at, have a look at those ones, and I'll just highlight there for you. We'll go on to the questions. All right, this one here, can you identify the use of fixed income and variable costs? The fixed income for these people is that their revenue doesn't change, so they're always getting the same level of income as it comes through. You might talk about a budgetary thing is, but it's not as though their revenue's like this. Their revenues is always like that for the people buying it. And their variable costs is like attached to their car use. So the more that they use their car, the more they're going to have to pay for this gas and petrol usage. If you could identify both of them, so the fixed income being level and the variable costs going on a gradient, or an incline, I should say, you can get yourself your 2 marks. Now, this is the tough question. Discuss why costs need to be kept low for all businesses to remain profitable. Here's the idea. So if you're going to define this one, you want to start talking about the idea about what is profitability. Your profitability is going to be based on once you've taken your revenue and you minus off your total costs, it's the profit that's left over. Profitability is going to be your ability to maintain that profitable aspect, i.e., your revenue is greater than your costs. On here, for my example, is going to be talking about inflation, and inflation is the part where the total cost keeps creeping up, whereas your fixed income is always staying level, and as it gets higher and higher, you're eventually going to hit that roof ceiling, and the costs are going to start creeping above. That's when you're making a loss and you're no longer profitable. What's some good bits about this? Well, as you're doing it, people start to go around searching for ways to get innovation to try to make these costs come down, such as biodiesels and so forth, or changing up the fuel production cycle. How else do I keep these costs low for businesses? It might encourage them to get their workers to multi-skill. It might also cause them outsourcing or offshoring. That'll bring about better economies of scale. You might also want to say, talk about your buying bulk in purchase. So trying to get them on the higher scale days and the cheaper days in order to make that cost come below their fixed income areas. This is meant to be a bit of a tough question for you. What are some negatives about this? So once the costs get too high, they go beyond that sort of fixed income level. One of the challenges is it basically puts businesses out of business. So they're no longer profitable. So the demotivation aspect's there as well. The other parts are a bit of a challenge is the motivation. So if you're using Taylorism to motivate your employees, or sort of like the you want to meet your hygiene factors with Hertzberg, it's going to be a real challenge. Meeting the basics is going to demotivate people, particularly on the lower levels of Maslow, because the security aspect's going to feel very threatened. Overall, it's recommended that costs are kept low for all businesses to remain profitable, because once inflation creeps above those levels of fixed income for certain people in society and businesses, you're going to get them essentially making a loss in that little gap area, and that's not good for anybody. All right, to finish up for today, have a go through the worksheet in the description bar below and answer the IB questions in your textbook. Read over 5.2 just to get it fresh in the head again. And just to see if you've been successful, do you think you can define your fixed, variable, semi-variable, direct, indirect, and overheads and contribution? Could you explain these ideas to somebody, ideally for 2 or 4 marks? And if you can give an example out of a case study, you can feel as though you're definitely heading towards the right direction. All right, that's it from me, and I'll see you again in 5.2B. Oh, sorry, I jumped right ahead of the gun there, didn't I? The higher level stuff. Friedrich von Wieser, he talked about opportunity cost to change the world. Good read into that one for some extension. And also the salvage value for some businesses so you can get some of that money back when you finally sell it. Have a look at Tutor2U and BizEd for some more details, some more fundamental stuff. And I'll get into it again. I'll see you later. I'll see you in 5.2B.